you got your Bibles, I want you to go to two places. I want you to go to Mark chapter 3, and I want you to go to Matthew chapter number 12. Now you're saying, preacher, I thought you were doing a series on Wednesday night on Daniel, and I am, and don't let your heart not be troubled. I'm not going to abandon it. I'm just leaving it for 1 week, because what I'm preaching tonight is more important than Daniel tonight, okay? I'm going to be talking, and I want you to, let me go ahead and read these verses. I started to read them maybe after I said a few opening remarks, but let me just read them first. Let's go to Mark chapter 3 first. If you're there, say amen. Amen. Now I want to ask a question of the class. I'm going to teach you like you, all of your class, and that whether you're saved or lost, I want you to answer this question. Now, are you looking at me? Think about what I'm saying. I don't want anybody to leave here. How many's ever heard of the unpardonable sin? Now, Sunday, I have absolutely been on my face praying for people who feel like they've committed the unpardonable sin since Sunday. I've been crying and weeping and praying. I was up this morning, 3 o'clock in the morning till about 4:30, just praying about the unpardonable sin and about folks who think that they have committed it. So what I want to do, I'll have a survey. This is about the most important question I can ask. And I may not answer it now, but I'll come back to it because it's real important. Now listen to it carefully. If you're unsaved, I want you to get involved in this. You get to vote. You get to vote just with every Christian. Because this question is to you. All right. How many unpardonable sins are there? Okay, is there one? If you believe there's only one unpardonable sin, raise your hand. Okay. How many believe there's more than one? No, you don't. You've been in this church long enough not to know that. You know better than that. Now, what I just said was very important to everything I'm going to say in a moment. Now, let me ask you again. Look up. I want to take the vote one more time. Look up here. How many of you believe there's only one? Right? Okay. That's what I need to know. Now, what we're going to do is take in the Word of God, and then we're going to find out exactly what it is. Because there's a lot of misconception about it. So I want to tell you what it is. I've done a lot of study this week. I've spent hours just reading these verses and taking notes. I may jerk something off the internet. Just studying. So look at the Bible. Go with me. And man, I hope I got enough time to finish this. Go with me to Mark chapter 3, verse 22. If you're there, say amen. Now notice the context. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, he hath Beelzebub, talking about Jesus, and by the prince of the devils casteth he out devils. And he called them unto himself and said unto them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? Man, that's a good question. And if a kingdom be divided against itself, the kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, the house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end. No man could enter into a strong man's house and spoils goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemes wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. And he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. Because they said he hath an, notice what they said, and they said he hath an unclean spirit. Are y'all there? Now turn to Matthew chapter 12. I'm trying to hurry in the reading, but I want to read both of these. There are actually three portions. Luke 11 covers the two, but I'm just covering two and tonight, if you don't mind, because there is a lot to say and I want to get it all out. How many's ever thought about this subject? This first time I ever preached a whole sermon on it, though I have alluded to it. Turn to Matthew chapter number 12. Are you there? And go down, let's just start in the same context in verse 24. Are you there? But when the Pharisees heard about what he had done, he had delivered dumb spirits and demon-possessed people. And when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fella doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. They were accusing Jesus of casting out devils by the devil. Hello. That's the context. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And Satan cast out Satan, he's divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, now notice that, the work of the Spirit, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. Or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the strong man? Sound familiar, don't it? And then he will spoil his house. He that is not with me is against me. And he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blaspheme against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. Now, what I'm going to do is explain all this, plus show you what it really means. And I want every one of you to take your Bible. Every place I say go, you go. Okay? You promise to do that? I'm going to read a little letter that was written to a preacher. Then I'm going to tell you a story. Then I'm going to go on into this. But I want to allude to this. First of all, what sin is the unpardonable sin? We'll talk about that in a minute. Some believe it's murder. I don't know if anybody in this room's ever murdered anybody. But I want you to know you can be forgiven of murder. Hey, there's Christians murder other Christians by talking about them or hating them. Amen. And then adultery. Do you know there's a church, and I'm going to call it out tonight, and if y'all get mad at me calling it like it is, you're just going to have to get glad. Because I tell it like, I'm going to tell it like it is, preacher. The Church of Christ, the Church of Christ believes that if you have been married and divorced and remarried, you cannot go to heaven. That's their unpardonable sin. Boy, they got to have a lot of problem with that woman at the well. She had been married 5 times and then was shacking up with somebody. And got saved, went and told the whole city got right with God. Now I'll read you. I'm going to read you something. Don't you hear everything I'm saying tonight? Then tell you a true story. That's right, factual. This letter was written to this preacher. I'd like to just know if what it says in Matthew is true. It states that every sin is forgivable except when a person speaks badly about the Holy Spirit. I've attended a private Christian school, and one day my Bible teacher was saying that a person is not forgiven if he speaks against the Holy Ghost. And he stated something, and that I said something by accident against the Holy Ghost. I didn't mean to say it. It just happened. I prayed and asked God's forgiveness. But does that mean I am forgiven, or am I eternally condemned? Clearly, this student was confused. I have a preacher friend. I won't call his name. I don't want to do it, but I have a preacher friend who I preached at his church. I had met this young man one time. He had a troubled young man that goes to his church. And he was out of church for a while, Michael. He's a Christian boy. And then he came in on one Wednesday night and got right. A week before he was going to graduate from high school. Got right with God. Came back. He got right. On Saturday, went up and washed the pastor's car. Cleaned it up, waxed it. That was at 3:00, and his parents were out to eat. And then he went up into his house, them gone, after doing what he could for the preacher, and hung himself. And committed suicide. And in his suicide letter, there was a portion of things said, I've just got to go on because I blasphemed the Holy Ghost and I spoke against the Holy Ghost. You know why he'd done such a dastardly thing? He didn't know what it was. And there's some of you in this room have no clue what it is. Now, let me give you an illustration. One more, and I'm done. I heard Curtis Hudson say this. It's a good statement. I've had the same thing said about me, so I'll just go about me. I've had folks say this. Because our church is big, we have to be compromisers. And they were attributing what was done here that they said I was of the devil. I was a compromiser because ain't nobody could have a church like this. And they attributed what we had done to the devil. Now, I think they're ignorant, but I don't think they committed the unpardonable sin. I've had folks condemn me. Hey, Brother Moses, I've had folks condemn me because we have youth ministries up there. And if there's a 5-year-old who wants to get saved, we lead them to Christ. Amen. And I've been told that we're doing it of the devil. No kid 5 years old can be saved. Amen. Well, my daughter's back there and she's 5 years old and got saved. Amen. I'm only making an illustration, okay? Now stay with me, because I'm going somewhere and I'm going to try to go a little faster. An unforgivable sin, this unforgivable sin described in Mark 3 and Matthew 12. These passages involve Jesus repeatedly going into these communities and defeating Satan in his strongholds and delivering people. Delivering dumb spirits and demons, and he did that. And many leaders and theologians have been confused about the true nature of the sin. And you read these verses for yourself. Bear in mind, Bear in mind, the purpose of Jesus Christ's ministry was to confront darkness with the light of truth.
Amen, preacher.
Am I preaching?
Yes.
And he is the only one with enough power to bind Satan himself and forcibly dispose a demon from him. And I want you to know something, you hear me out. The Bible said if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, whom the God of this world hath blinded their minds. Somebody help me preach.
Amen, preacher.
Stay with me. I'm going somewhere. And I want you to follow me there. The Pharisees had long observed the sinlessness of Jesus. How many of y'all believe he's the sinless Son of God? They observed him doing undeniable, powerful miracles. Clear evidence of the power of the Holy Ghost. These miracles were given freely and in pure kindness. Somebody say amen. However, listen to this. The Pharisees had so firmly set their heart against accepting Jesus as Messiah, they rejected the obvious truth before them and perversely twisted its influence to the crowds. Somebody say amen there. That's what they were doing. This original sin was committed by the Pharisees and Sadducees, and that what they did in their sin was reject Christ and reject the power of the Holy Ghost. Now you stay with me, I'm proving everything I'm saying tonight. Now hear me out. Here's where I want you to go with me in your Bible. Some of you already voted. You already voted, Joe, didn't they?
Yep.
We've already voted. They just one of them.
Right?
Hey, sir, that's lost. Man, that's lost. How many are there? One. See, I want you to know something. The unforgivable sin of speaking against the Holy Spirit has been interpreted various ways. But I want you to know something. The true meaning cannot contradict. A meaning that you might have can't contradict the Bible. You say, well, years ago, I said something bad about the Holy Ghost. Hold a minute. Turn with me. You got your Bibles? Now it's time to start bearing down. Turn to John. John chapter number 3 and verse 18. Many of y'all ought to be able to quote it. How many's there? Are you there, sir? Are you there, ma'am? Now I won't read it to you. John 3:18. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Here it is. He that believeth on him is not condemned. But he that believeth not is condemned already. Because he had not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. John 3:36. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa. I just want to ask somebody a question. Sir, you, Denny, it's your time to shine. Let me ask you something. What was the unpardonable sin in them verses I just read?
Turning your back on the Holy Ghost.
And not believing on the Son. Rejecting the call of God by the Holy Spirit. And not believing in the Son. Am I preaching? Oh, stay with me. I ain't done. So let's look at this. In context of this particular passage in Matthew 12, Jesus had performed great miracles of creation involving both healing and casting out a demon. But the Pharisees rejected this clear witness of the Holy Spirit. They rejected it. It's not just saying, oh, Holy Spirit, you're bad. That ain't what it's talking about. It's talking about rejecting what the work of the Holy Spirit is. Now, stay with me. How many believe I'm going somewhere? Instead, they attributed his powers to Satan, thus demonstrating an attitude permanently resistant to the Spirit and to the deity and saving gospel of Christ. Speaking against the Son might be due to a failure of recognizing him for who he was. Paul spoke against the Son until the light hit him. Somebody say amen. And you say, well, Preacher Smith, how do I speak against the Spirit then? Glad you asked. Because I think some of you think you've spoke against the Spirit and you haven't, and that you're feeling guilty, and you don't think you could be saved, and you don't really understand what it means. So, if you got your Bible, let's do some more study. Y'all all follow me? Turn to John 16. John 16. Come on now. John 16. If you're there, say amen. I want to start reading at verse 7. If you're there, say amen. Because we're talking about sinning against the Holy Ghost. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Now here it is. You want to know what the work of the Holy Spirit is? Right here it is. And to speak against him is to go against what his work is right here. Nothing more, nothing less. You can say the Lord's name in vain and still go to heaven. I don't want you to, but you could. Here it is. When he, that's the Holy Ghost, is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of what? Judgment. Three things he's going to do is show people their sin. You talked about righteousness a little bit ago, and judgment. Of sin because they what? Wait a minute. What is the sin? Oh, attributing some miracle to the devil? No, the miracle of miracles is a new birth. Look at this. Of sin because they believe on me not. I want everyone to listen to me, and Allison may flash something up for me here in a moment. When it's regarding sinners, now I know there's different sins for saints. There's seven sins that the Lord hates. You know that there is a characterizing sin. But when it comes to sinners, God does not categorize sin. There's only one sin that God will not forgive. And there's only one unpardonable sin. And it's there. Of sin because they believed on him not. Show the little graphic for me. Look at there. This is how we view sin. Okay, lying is bad. Look at that. And stealing's bad. Adultery, it's real bad. Lust, kind of bad. Anger, kind of bad. Unbelief, yeah. Murder, woo, out the charts. Idolatry. Y'all listen? See, we would say one of those is worse than the others. But when you come to the cross, the ground's level. Sin, sin. And there's only one sin. Now let's see how God views it. Woo! Straight across. There ain't no characterizing sin. Somebody help me preach right here. Am I preaching? See, your problem, ladies and gentlemen, is you categorize sin. You're saying, now go back to John 16. You're saying that if I said this about the Holy Ghost or some kind of stupid something, That's not forgivable. But I can go ahead and lie, cheat, steal, murder, and everything else. But there ain't but one, he said. Look at John 16. Y'all there?
Amen.
And of sin because they believe on me not. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. Now listen to me. Look at me now. The Holy Spirit comes and convicts you three ways. Of sin, the sin of unbelief. Not all that stuff. That's just byproducts of your unbelief. No. When you start having faith in the blood of Jesus, you can be saved. And then he's of righteousness. You ain't got no righteousness. And then of judgment. Every one of us going to face judgment. Now, I want you to go now to the most important verse I'm going to cover all night. Because I am going to nail all of us to the ground on this verse. Turn to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 6. Everybody turn there. Because I'm finishing here. Maybe. Are y'all there? Well, I was, and I lost it. I didn't lose my salvation, I lost my place. Okay, hold a minute. Y'all there?
Amen.
Now let me ask you again, how many unpardonable sins are there?
One.
Sir, ma'am, how many?
One.
You're right. And I'm gonna show it to you right here. Right here in the Bible. Watch. Y'all there?
Amen.
Watch. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance. Here it is. Here it is. You look at me. Look at me. I want you to hear this. Here's what the blaspheme of the Holy Ghost is. It's when you've tasted of the Holy Ghost and the call of God for your last time, for your last call, and you rejected him. You said no. Then there's no repentance and there's no forgiveness. And you may have been taught, I said something bad about the Holy Ghost. Listen to me, you've been confused about it. I'm gonna tell you, the sin, I just read it to you. What are you gonna do with that, ma'am? What are you gonna do with that, sir? Somebody that has been enlightened, told that they know Jesus died. They tasted it. Let me ask you this. Hold a minute. Another quiz. How many of you know that he died, was buried, and rose again? Raise your hand. Boy. Then why aren't you saved? If you die and go to hell, it ain't going to be because you did some lip thing and have some guilt complex tonight about some sin and you think you attributed some miracle to the devil. Hold it a minute. I'll tell you why you'll go to hell. You'll go to hell because you rejected Jesus. Y'all still with me? I'm giving you verses. I'm trying to tell you what it is. How many's learned something already tonight? Sure you have. Now I'm going to give you some conclusions. Then I want you to listen to me carefully. First, God actively punishes unconfessed sin, not only after the sinner's death, but even during their life. Because the ways of the transgressors is hard. Amen? Furthermore, when God gives one over, now, hell, I'm going somewhere. Now, I almost forgot it. Turn to one more verse. I almost forgot the most important thing. I got to show you all this. If I go 2 minutes over, will y'all forgive me? I got to get this out right. Turn to Romans 1. Real quick. Real quick. Dear Lord, Chad. I didn't know I had all this in me tonight, but I got it. Y'all there? Hurry. I want to show you this thing. Romans 1. Verse 1. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without what? Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into a image made like a corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Y'all still with me? Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who trained the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. Don't tell me homosexuality is not mentioned in the New Testament. And likewise also the men leaving the natural use of woman, burning their lusts one to another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. Now listen to this verse. Ready? And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Look at me. You want to know when you get to a reprobate mind, you've sinned away your day of grace? Is when you have no desire for God at all. Are y'all listening? Did you just read that that's the unpardonable sin? When he takes you and gives you a reprobate mind? And that is rejecting him. Now stay with me. I'm going to say this to you. I don't want you to look at your Bible now. I want you to look at me. Everybody look at me. Just look at me. Come on now, look at me. It's important that you look at me. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. I'm going to repeat this 3 times. The Holy Spirit convicts you to be saved. If you have committed the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost, you will have no desire to be in church, no desire to be saved, no desire to be forgiven. You'll not want any of it. Now listen to this statement, and I'm done. Here it is, listen. Oh, look at me again, you ain't looking at me. Every one of you bowing your head, I'm coming after you. Here it is, here's the statement. If one's conscience is bothering him to the point that he feels he is too guilty for God to forgive, he has the assurance of God's word that forgiveness is possible. Listen to this. The very fact that he is bothered by his sinfulness shows that the Holy Ghost has not abandoned him, nor has given him up to a reprobate mind. Sir, ma'am, the mere fact that you still feel guilty and still want God to save you means you have not committed the unpardonable sin. And you are still able to be saved. And if you die and go to hell tonight, it won't be because of you saying something stupid like, down there at Taze Valley, they're doing works of the devil. No, that's not what gets you unpardonable sin. Here's what it is. For me to preach Jesus like I had tonight, come on now. You all said you believed he died, was buried, and rose again. You're in church tonight, so that tells me you ain't committed no unpardonable sin. You want God tonight. You want to be saved tonight. The devil's told you can't, and you done went too far. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, that's a lie. The mere fact that you're bothered means that you ain't never committed to unpardonable sin. Because if you ever do that, you won't come within a mile of a church. You won't even have a Bible. You'll burn them all. But the mere fact you still have tears, and the mere fact you still want to be around us, means that you have not. And if you die and go to hell, it ain't gonna be because of some arbitrary something you think you done 30 years ago. It's because you reject what I preach about Jesus. Holy Spirit saying to you, you want the sin against him is? Holy Spirit says, Jesus is real. You all you got to do is believe in Jesus. You believe him, you'll be saved. And here's how you go to hell. Here's how you sin against him. No. 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 And you say it for the last time. And it's over. But it ain't over till it's over. And God's forgiveness is still here. And the very fact you've got a guilty conscience tells me that you still can be saved. And you need to forget that lie the devil told you. Amen. Somebody ought to be on the altar praying. Pray for people tonight. Heads bowed, eyes closed. How many in this room know if you die tonight, you'd go to heaven if you died tonight? Raise your hand if you know you'd go to heaven if you died tonight. Stand to your feet. How many, stand. How many of you in this room tonight would like to be saved? If God would save you, you want to be saved. Stand to your feet, everybody. Preacher Smith, I don't want to go to hell. If you don't want to go to hell, raise your hand and tell me you don't want to go to hell. Then if you raise your hand and said you didn't want to go to hell, you have not committed the sin, the unpardonable sin, because there ain't nobody committed unpardonable sin will raise their hand and say they don't want to go to hell because they want to go to hell. They want to leave this world lost. You know what you all do? Holy Spirit's begging you tonight. Come to me. Come, I'm going to point you to Jesus. He shed his blood. I don't care how bad you've been. If you believe in your heart that Christ died and was buried and rose again and confess with your mouth, he'll save you. And I want to tell you, you need to get that junk out of you, that false doctrine out of your mind, and come and get saved. There'll be, I want one of my preachers standing right here. If you want saved, you raise your hand and say, you don't want to go to hell. If you don't want to go to hell, come up and get saved. And don't tell me you can't, you can. The devil says you can't, but God says you can. If you still have a guilty conscience, that is really telling you, you have not committed the sin unto death. Our Father, I give you the old call. Sweet Holy Ghost, go to anybody in this room that thinks they went too far, but they still want to be saved, and they don't want to go to hell. Go to them tonight. Persuade them, Lord, to come up to the altar and believe the gospel and believe what the Holy Spirit's telling them about Jesus. And Lord, you'll save them. In Jesus' name, amen. Come. Amen. At least one of you said that you don't want to go to hell. Well, you sit by your seat right now and come up here. Let's take the Bible and show you how to be saved. Come on. You've been deceived.
And he will surely give you rest by trusting in
his word. You ought to be up here. You ought to be up here. Oh, dear God.
Him.
Dear God, don't reject him. Don't reject him. Sir, ma'am, don't reject him.
Trust him.
Trust him tonight.
Now, he will save you. He will save you. He will save you.
I want you to look at me. Something you done 30 years ago. Something you done 30 years ago ain't gonna take you to hell. But I want you to know Jesus will save you today. Sing a little more.
For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow.
That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Only trust him now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you.
All right.
Now.
I don't want to shut this meeting down. But if you go to hell, ma'am, you go to hell, sir, don't you be making some excuse that, oh, I said something about the Holy Ghost and some miracle. Nope, nope, no, no, no. You're going to hell because you're rejecting the call of God. That's why. Anybody else in here? Only people go to hell is those that reject God. Not your lying, not your stealing, not your murder, nothing else. Rejecting God. And quit making excuses. You may have a lot of guilt, but there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. If y'all think I want to quit, I don't. But they got to obey the Holy Ghost. I ain't going to manipulate them. I ain't gonna work on your guilt. I ain't gonna manipulate you. If you ain't sensed the Holy Ghost on you tonight, then son, you are getting close because you're rejecting God. It ain't something you've done in 1955 or 85 or 87 or 2000. It's what you're doing tonight.
Amen.
Father, thank you for the service. Thank you for the liberty to preach this. Thank you for the mind you give me to give it out. I hope people learn something tonight. I sure have learned something myself. God, thank you for the sweet Holy Ghost that reveals things to us. Now reveal to this man tonight. Come on, son. You won't be saved. Hold a minute. Hold a minute. All right, I'll come down there.
Father, Lord, we come to you right now, knowing that eternity is serious business. It's nothing to mess around with. It's nothing to take lightly. Father, I pray that you would work right now, Father, and that you would deal with people tonight. Father, not just those that are lost, but those that are forgiven, those that are saved. Father, may we have a renewed burden for people who are lost and on their way to hell. Father, I'm amazed at people that just don't care, Christians that just don't care about people who are lost and dying and going to hell. Father, I pray that you'd give us a renewed burden. Father, I pray that you'd give us a renewed desire to reach this world with the gospel, to reach our friends, to reach our coworkers, to reach our neighbors, to reach our family, not caring what people are going to think about us, but knowing that the gospel is true, knowing that salvation is real, knowing that you are real, and knowing that you are able to save to the uttermost. Father, I pray that you would deal right now with the hearts of your people, deal with those that are lost. Father, I pray that you would just bless this time. Father, we can't put you in a box, Lord. We cannot put you in a certain time frame. Father, we've got to obey the Spirit. And Father, I pray that you give us a desire to follow you now, Father. I pray that you'd be with us now, that you'd work mightily. You give Pastor John the words that he needs to say. Father, I pray that you soften hearts, you break down walls. Father, I pray that you bind the hands of Satan. Father, I pray, I claim the blood tonight. I plead the blood of Jesus Christ, that the father of lies would convince anyone to reject you and to reject the gospel. Father, I plead the blood right now. And Father, I claim the blood. We know that there is power in the blood. Father, we know that the blood is the only way that we can have salvation. The blood is the only way that we can have remission of sins. And Lord, we know that anywhere that the blood is, that the devil is going to have to flee because he cannot cross the bloodline. Father, we pray to you right now that you'd work. Father, that you'd get Satan out of this place. And Father, that you would bind hell tonight. Father, you said that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. Here we are, the church of the living God. Father, we're not trying to manipulate anything. Father, we're not trying to work on people's emotions. All we're trying to do is to live the Word of God, to believe the Word of God and what it says, that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Lord, we believe that. Doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter how old you are, doesn't matter how young you are, doesn't matter how sinful you are, doesn't matter if you're black, doesn't matter if you're white, doesn't matter if you're red, blue, green. Father, you love, and your salvation is open to all that would come. Father, you said that if you'd be lifted up, you'd draw all men to you. Father, we're lifting you up tonight. We're trusting in you. And Father, we thank you so much for this time. And Lord, I pray that you would just help us now. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Listen before you leave. Please pray. And I want you to hear this. The call of God's not a lightning bolt. And it's not feelings. It is God's trying to show you to place faith in his son. And if you die and go to hell, it's because you don't place in your faith in that, not some feeling. But if you raise your hand up high and said you don't want to go to hell, that wasn't Satan that done that. That's the Holy Ghost that done that. And you can walk out this door and say no one more time. Get that heart a little harder. And I'm, you done got me a nervous wreck. But I am dismissing. Do I want to? No. But I cannot do the work of the Holy Ghost. And I refuse to try. That's why I asked the gentleman to go back to his seat. Because I can't do that. I'm not God. But I tell you what y'all can do is pray for him that the Holy Ghost troubles him so much the bed gets hard and he can't sleep. and he's miserable, and he'll call me up and want to be saved. And I'll come to you, buddy. Our Father, my heart is totally broke. I'm hurting, upset, church is upset. But it ain't us, Lord. It's this dear man I'm burdened about. Raise his hand, he's lost. Raise his hand, he don't want to go to hell. But then the devil tells him, you ain't feeling it. You ain't got the right feeling. You ain't got the right feeling. Lord, it ain't our feelings. It's the facts that you died, was buried, rose again. And I trusted you. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Good night. God bless all y'all.